test.
Oh, good grief, you're out there. Lightning light shining on your face because I can't see you. Hi.
Hey, why don't we stand up?
Let's do that. Is there a set list?
They're just Carl songs, so they're all super easy.
This is a combination between a roast and a celebration.
Yeah. feel alone. I feel safe. I feel Jesus in this place. We sing
glory to the King.
We sing.
just who you are. Thank you for shining like the morning star. I love you.
This is the first woman to lead worship for the vineyard.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
think they're going to move. Okay, think now. Move. Oh. Don't move. There we go. You know what? I'm not going to need it. No, I'm not. I'm going to sit. No.
Just okay. Have a seat for a second. No. I wrote some things down because I knew that I would probably not be in good shape. You probably think I'm in good shape. Probably like this. I don't like this. No. This is I never set out to be known as a worship leader. I just was starving and thirsty, was drawn to the bread of life and the rivers of living water. There was a time in my life, about 10 years after I'd come to Christ, there were two verses that would haunted me in the scripture. One was in John 6 and said, I am the bread of life, and whoever comes to me will never hunger. Amen. And whoever believes in me will never go thirsty. I never liked reading those verses. I don't like a conceptual idealized Christianity. I like one that has legs and arms and a heart. So all the ethereal things and stuff like that don't do a lot for me. But that he would be my substance, and my sustaining power. That he would quench my thirst. Which I've discovered a long time ago, that he doesn't just quench it, but he caused it. So that's always a comforting thing, because I can't get hungry for God. I can't get thirsty for the Holy Spirit's move. When I do that, I just get religious. And so what happens is God sovereignly, and sometimes unexpectedly, hears my cry and answers my cry, my plea, and then he satisfies the very thirst that he created. He satisfies the very hunger that he created, and that's who God is, and that's what God does. I have other things on this paper that he does. I need my glasses again. I'm telling you, it's been 40 years since I started on this journey. I remember being with this group that met in my sister's house like 40 years ago, I mean, or longer than that. And then the church that we're at that time wasn't real comfortable with us meeting unsupervised. And so they asked us if we'd bring our meeting up to the church. And so we said, sure. And went with that. They were talking to me and asking me to be there. They were asking John and Carol. But along with John and Carol came me and a bunch of other ragtag people.
and really some people that weren't acceptable to the church. And I remember that night I opened prayer and I said, Lord, we're naked, wretched, poor, and blind. And Lord, we need you to clothe us in your righteousness. We need you to touch our eyes so we might see you. So it was just from my heart, and it was a cry of desperation, because there's nothing worse than knowing about God, in my opinion. There's nothing worse than knowing about God, but not knowing God. Knowing about God and all that He does and all that He is and all that He can be, but not experience it. And you know, we over the years we kind of started being labeled as a group that was, you know, experiential. And I was puzzled by that. I think, well, what kind of Christianity do you want to have? That you don't want one that has an experience that goes along with all the rhetoric. And so, but that place where we started was a place of desperation that I think God created in us and me and other people, and then he satisfied it. But it's a really, really, really tough thing. Really tough thing to stay in a needy place. To stay in a place of brokenness, to stay in a place of being bowed down. And yet that's where God meets us. And yet, look at what we do with what we have. Not to chastise anybody or anything, but like we have an unbelievable amount of freedom, unbelievable amount of information. People, you know, ask me sometimes like some things about worship, and I said, just go to iTunes. There's a lot better things on there than I have. There's so much information at our hands, and so we kind of lose our neediness, and it doesn't look good to be needy. It doesn't look good to be desperate. It doesn't sound good. But that's, if we want to sustain the presence of God and the pleasure of God, we have to stay in a broken place. So we're never strong. We're never able to do this without Him. Because if we could do it without Him, it just becomes religion. It's just stuff that we do. And I don't know about you, but I'm tired of the stuff we do. I really am. I just want to know Him. And I want to know the power of His resurrection. So, John used to, this is the 20th anniversary of John's passing. And he used to say, the way in is the way on. And that the only way you can get in, the only way in that doorway is to bow low and drink deep. You can't get it any other way. You can't get it at a conference. You can't get it through some person standing up and that, you know, pushes you down or something. You just, you know, you get it through meeting with God. Psalm 42:1 says, you know, as deer pants after the water, so my heart pants after you, O God. When will I meet with God? That should be the question that we always are having when we're gathering. When will we meet with God? When will we meet with Him and experience Him in His presence? Because there really isn't anything more comforting. I've gone through a rough year, in a way. I've had two strokes, and they've affected me a bit here and there. I don't dance like I used to. I really prayed that I would be healed and be able to do prophetic dance for the night, but it didn't happen. It must not have been God's will. But in that, you know, in those times, the first one I had, I didn't know what was going on, and I was preoccupied for the first 11 hours with my friends. And I say that very, very gingerly, my friends. They probably gave me the stroke to begin with. And then they were probably working on finishing me off when I was in the emergency room. And so after they cleared out, it was actually incredibly wonderful to have so many people in the emergency room. There weren't supposed to be anybody, but they just crowded in. And I told the nurse, get them out. She said, no, I'm having a blast. What a bunch of jokers. But as I laid there at night, about midnight, I laid there and I thought, good grief, man, I almost died. And I was okay. I was really okay. I was at peace, but I'm glad I didn't die, and I'm glad I've lived, and I was able to finish my book, because my book is really the story of my life in whatever form it is. But it is of God being lavish and exceedingly abundant in His grace and His mercy, and consistently poured Himself out in my life. I mean, I didn't, like I said, I didn't start out to be known as a worship leader. And now I'm like so known as a worship leader that now it's like I have to say, no, I'm not a worship leader. Because they want me to come lead worship, because they have a memory of how things used to be. And it's not that way today. And so the reason I'm laying this down is because I don't want to ruin your memory. Just keep the memory of that tall, thin, long-haired guy who led you to the presence of God. And just leave me there. But anyway, when I had the strokes, it was a wonderful thing because my family's been all separated all up through the United States, and all my kids came, and they were with me for 3 days, and they were wonderful. They never used their phones or their iPads or anything. They just sat in a circle, and we just probably made fun of each other, but they kind of got that from their mom's side. But, so anyway, that was a wonderful thing, and it really did something in me and for me. And it did something, I think, in our family. And then most recently, my son Noah, who's here, hit a rough patch, And his life became unmanageable and out of control. And he, thank God, was willing to recognize that. His sisters spoke to him. His sisters are wonderful. So they spoke to him. And anyway, but he's taken what he needed to take. I mean, sometimes you get yourself in a really bad place and you don't know how to get out. So you got to get help. So he's been getting help, and he's here, and he's healthy, almost. He's got liver damage, and they don't know what extent it is. They diagnosed it as cirrhosis, but they'll find out what degree it is or where it's at in its progress in like 3 months. So we have 3 months to just pray it away. And be fine. And he's gonna. I'm not gonna make him come up here, but I will make him stand up. Where are you, Noah? Right there. So I know there's several of you that want to pray for him and bless him, and he said that's okay. You know, I said, you know, I have like weird friends. They're gonna want to pray for you and pray on you. And it's not good enough from a distance. So when this is over, we'll bless him. And he's actually at a place he's gonna be having to start his life. His job is gone. It's a tough circumstance. But anyway, so if the usher would come, we're gonna take an offering, and it's gonna go to helping him. If you write a check, it's gonna be to the vineyard at the river. And so all the funds will go to the vineyard at the river, and we'll manage those funds to help him get on his feet and get the help he needs and needs to get on it with life, you know. So I don't want him to, you know, we're not enabling him, but we're helping him, okay? So Lord, bless this offering and bless those who give it, and bless Noah. Lord, we thank you for him. We thank you for his life and the love he has for his children and the joy he has in them and just all that you made him be. So bless him, Lord. Thank you. Amen. Okay. So you can pass the offering. And then as you do, I'm going to say something about this crew. These people, I mean, they're all, except for Bill. Bill back there, he's no guy like me. But anyway, all these people, they've become intertwined in my life, and they're very, very special to me. They're very special in the whole worship world. And so they represent a people that speak our language. You know? So I'm very, very, very grateful for them, and grateful that they would so willingly come and share with me in this time. And you know, Daniel Cox in the video, you know, we're videoing, streaming live, I guess. People from around the world are watching this, and that's awesome. And it really is honestly overwhelming to me. It is way beyond anything I could ever comprehend, and way beyond anything I could have ever done on my own. So I love the help of my friends, and I'm very grateful for them. I'm very grateful they're here. Grateful Daniel and Danny. Danny's doing the sound. He brought everything. It's not like this place doesn't have sound and stuff. But he brought everything. He set everything up. He worked with those people back behind me. They're kind of rebellious. They're a difficult group. And I've carried the weight of them for all these years. Why is that funny? No, I'm blessed by them, and I'm blessed by you. I really am. As I started to think about the people that would be here tonight, and you stretch all the way back to when I was 11, and then through all the years, and it's so incredible to see people that are still walking and still pressing into the things of God. Even though if you're anything like me at all, you know less about God than you did 50 years ago. You can't, there is no end to him. And so you're always discovering. You're always learning. You're always growing. So that's just the way it is with God. So, and it's fun to have people that are on the same journey and understand your journey, understand your struggles, and are very compassionate and gracious and kind. I thought about how gracious and kind you have all have been to me, and it obviously is not easy for me to handle that. I don't even know what to do with it. It wrecks me. And you know what else wrecks me is how good God has been to me. I'm wrecked. That's what ruins me. That's what goes through my mind, and I start making noises, just unbelievable. Because I just, man, I'm overwhelmed with the goodness of God.
Amen.
And His goodness and His graciousness. And so let me just wrap this little thing up with back to what John said. John said, the way in His way. I know that we're always fascinated by the next, you know, seminar that's going to change your life, and the book that's going to change your life. And Jesus changes lives. And He uses that other stuff. He uses my book, mostly. Shut up. But anyway, no, it's about Him. And that's why these people are here, and the songs that they write touch and move your heart and lives. And so we're going to just finish up. But I do want to say I love you, and I'm grateful for you. And it's just very difficult for me to comprehend. I know that I don't deserve it. But I also know that's how God is. And so thank you for being here. And we're just going to continue to worship with a few more songs. Breathe and Holy Noin One and other songs that you guys wrote. Okay? Don't stare at me like that. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you.
Holy hand, anointed
drawn us to this place.
To honor you.
we were in Australia together, and we were supposed to lead worship together. And so we led one song, and then I thought, okay, I'm done. And so I left him up there.
Yeah, you did.
Yeah, I just carried the whole set.
I've been waiting for this moment.
I sat down right where he could see me, and the pastor's wife leaned over to me. She goes, he starts singing Hosanna. And she goes, oh, he's honoring you. No, that's not what that is.
Take it away,
John. No, I want to learn it right, so I'm gonna.
Oh God.
Does anybody want Carl to lead it?
This is...
Chino, right? And Fullerton and Whittier. And this, what? Whatever. It's a good church. No, it's a really great church. I mean, it was one of my last stops before I came back into the vineyard. And
And they were very, very, very gracious and kind to me, and very embracing of me. And it was really healing to me. I lived with one of the pastors and his wife and their three daughters. And I was reflecting. I was sitting in the bedroom one time, and you know, I had been in the desert and had that a good experience there. But then I was in this little house in this little bedroom, and I'm sitting there thinking, oh my gosh! I mean, like I think I'm at 58 or 57 or whatever at that time. And I'm sitting there thinking, I'm in the bedroom in somebody's house, and so I kind of thought that was a bummer, you know. And then I thought, well, I'll go and sit with the girls. So I went into the living room to sit with the girls because they're lovely little young ladies. And this one came and cuddled up next to me. She looks at me with big blue eyes. She goes, Carl. I said, yes, Aaron. She goes, are you poor? I had to think about it. I thought, well, no, I'm not poor. And she goes, well, you don't have your own house and you live with us. And I went back into my bedroom. What an experience. So, Alan, you're not here. Well, Alan and the gang allowed us to be here and take over the place, and I don't have anything else to say. I just gotta hug people and whatever. But I didn't really even do it tonight. But I really feel like God is moving me on to other things, and I just wanted to share with people that honesty is not there to hurt you. It's there to help you. And you find it difficult to be honest in the church, but there's a place where you can be, but I'd fight for that. And you know, Jesus said, "The truth shall set you free."
Amen.
And what's so incredible about it is it really does. I mean, when you have no secrets, when you have nothing to hide, and you're just living as you are, as God made you, in His sight, it's incredibly freeing. It's incredibly liberating. It's really wonderful. So I'm a blessed. There really aren't words to describe what I've experienced throughout the years, and I hope to experience for many more years. So let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you so much for gracing us with your presence here. Lord, thank you for the hearts that you rekindled. You lit again. Lord, the thirsty souls that you met, the hungry spirits, Lord, that you've satisfied. Lord, help us to learn to be satisfied with you each and every day. I just thank you, Lord. Amen. Right. Bye.
Is that prophetic dancing, Carl? Those hand motions?
You're animals back on the drums. Go home! Go home!
Thank you. I thought this was the hardcore car.
Thank you, Rick.
Thank you.
Thank you.